This it's time now, right? Okay, last time we introduced the following notions. Suppose X row is a metric space. And X naught or X is any point in X and R greater than 0, then we defined V R X, namely the set of all y in X whose distance from X is less than R. We also introduce V R bar X, which is the set of all y in X such that rho X Y less than or equal to R. And we also introduce the notion of the sphere, which is the set of all y in X such that rho X Y. And this we called the open ball, of course center X and radius R. This is always okay, center X, centered at X and of radius R. And this we call the closed ball, centered at X and of radius R. And this we call as the sphere centered at X and of radius R. So these basic notions that we introduced last time. And this open ball is also called the R neighborhood of the point X. We also use knowledge sometimes R of X. Okay, so these are the three important notions. So we shall develop from here on using these, particularly this notion of the open ball. So now suppose I have a metric space. From now on, everything will be with respect to a metric space unless otherwise specified. Now I look at, this is the metric space, and inside that I look at a subset A. So let A be a subset of X. So we have to look at a small piece probably of the metric space. Now I am going to look at any point A in A. So a point A in A. Now intuitively I look at it, I call it interior point. Inside there is an about that point which is completely in the set, okay, is called an interior point of the set A if there exists an R neighborhood of the point A which lies in A. That is, I state that an R neighborhood, that means there must be a radius R such that if I draw the open ball about that point A with radius R, that must be inside. That is, if there exists R greater than 0 such that B R A is contained. Okay. The interior point. It is an intuitive notion which we, that is how we see interiors in common. If you stand there, right at the door, that's not interior, because if you draw any neighborhood of it, part of it is outside the set. So we look at an interior point in this sense, that there is a neighborhood around that point which lies completely inside the set. Now, it's a simple example. Let us consider the metric space R with the usual matrix. Rho of x, y is mod of x minus y. When I put mod, means the usual matrix, y is modulus x minus y. Then consider the set A to be the set of all x such that 0 less than or equal to x less than 1. This, I am going to look at all those points from 0 to 1. Zero is not an interior point, because whatever neighborhood you draw, part of it lies outside. So clearly, every point x in A such that 0 less than x less than A less than 1 is an interior point of A, but 0 is not an interior point of it. Now let's look at one more example, which is general. Okay. Let's take a metric space X row. Let us take any point A in X and consider an open ball B R A. I have the point A. I am going to look at the open ball of S. Okay, inside all those points. Now take any other point x inside that ball. Okay. So I am going to take my set A to be B or A. I am going to look at what are all the interior points of this. Intuitively, we see that every point will be an interior point. Now we have to actually analytically see it. Okay. So take any point x in A. I want to see whether I can draw an open ball about this point which will lie completely inside A in order to determine whether x is an interior point. So now consider, okay, let us call R naught to be the distance between A and X. This distance is R naught. The distance between A and X to be R naught. So let R 1 be any number greater than 0, and then look at BR1X. So I am going to draw a sphere or a ball of radius R1 about the point X. Right. So now if Y belongs to BR1X, so let me draw a separate picture here. Here is A, here is X, and Y is some point in that. This distance is R naught, and this distance will be less than R, because it is inside the ball of radius R1 about the point X. Now that says the distance between A and Y by triangle inequality is this less than the distance between A and X and X and Y. Therefore, that is less than R naught plus R 1, right? Because rho and A x distance is R naught, at the x and y distance is less than R 1. So therefore, it is less than R naught plus R 1. This will be less than R if R 1 is less than R minus R naught. Is that clear? R naught is smaller than R. So, R minus R naught is positive. So, therefore, I have to choose an R 1 which is less than this positive number. So, for instance, let R 1 to be R minus R naught by 3, right? Then, rho if I draw about the point x, all of radius R 1, where R 1 is this, all the points will be within this globe, right? All the points will be within the distance R from A, which means all those points inside that small ball are lying inside the big ball, and therefore about the point x we have an open ball which lies completely inside the set. Okay. So, therefore, for every y, hence by choosing R 1 to be equal to R minus R naught by 3, we see that y belongs to B R 1 x implies y belongs to BR1A, which implies BR1X is completely contained in BRA, which is our A. Okay. Therefore, every x in BRA is an interior. Every point of an open ball is an interior point. That is the conclusion. Every point of an open ball will be an interior point of the open ball. Simple but useful observation. Okay. Now, what we do is take any metric space X row and any point, any set in X. Then we collect all the interior points of A. So let A naught, A superscript 0 denote the set of all interior points of A. So what does that mean? It is a subset of A, obviously. Among the points of A, I am choosing only those which are interior points. Therefore, A naught is a subset of A. It may happen one, there is nothing in A naught, no point is an interior point, or it is strictly non-empty strictly non-empty, but strictly a subset of proper empty subset of A. It's not empty, it's not A, it's somewhere in between. Or it may happen that A naught is A. All three possibilities are there. And what we have seen is that if you take an open ball, the first two are ruled out. A naught will be definitely equal to A. We call all such sets as open sets. A set is called an open set if A naught equal to E. Okay? So, okay, anyway, A naught is called the interior of A. Actually, I have lots of friends who are interior decorators. I tell them, you are a decorator, don't fool around with the wall. The wall is not an interior. Okay? So, but unfortunately, they fool around with the all wall maximum, with all plywoods and cupboards and whatnot. Anyway, so now we have this definition. We give this important, most fundamental definition. A subset A of a metric space X row is called an open set if A naught. What does that mean? That is, every point of A is an interior point. I keep repeating the property. What does this mean? That is, for every A in A, there exists a possible radius R, which may depend on A, such that the ball is completely untangled. This is what is point A is in, right? So we want it for every A, and therefore every A becomes an interior point. We get A equal to A. So a set is said to be an open set if every point of the set is an interior point. Let us look at some example. I erased it, but let's keep it. Let me keep that definition. Interior point of A. That is, for every A, there exists an RA greater than 0, such that BRA, A completely containing A. That is, every point of A. This is what I had. Okay, let me keep this definition. Okay, so now let me look at some examples. What is the interior of the empty set? Must be empty, there is nothing in it, so no point can be an empty set. So this is it. So therefore the empty set is an open set according to our definition, because interior is equal to, so by our definition the empty set is an open set. Second trivial example, what is the interior of the whole space itself? Because about any point, you draw any ball, everything is in X. So, that the universe itself is there. So, there is no problem. That is X. Therefore, X is an open set. Now, let us look at the real line with the usual metric space. Now consider this set. We have already seen that except 0, everything is an interior point, and therefore A is not an open set. So A naught is not equal to A. In this case, strictly A naught is a proper subset of A, so A naught is not an open set. In the same metric space, now look at A to be the set of all between 0 and 1, 0 not included, 1. Now what happens to interior itself? Because it's an open ball. It's an open ball of radius half about the point half. Okay. So every open ball, the interior is that. So A not equal to A, therefore A is open. And of course, by our definition there, I will write here 2A. Every open ball in a metric space is an open set, because we have shown here that every point in an open ball is an interior point. So every open ball has the interior itself and therefore is an open set. Okay. Now let us look at some more examples. Let us take the set of all positive integers. Okay. What is the interior? No matter which integer I take, whatever ball I draw, there will be points outside the set A. So no point is an interior point. The interior is empty here. And therefore, this is not an open set. What about the rational? It is the same. Whatever rational number I take and draw, whatever ball I draw, there will be irrational points in that, and therefore, again, it is empty. So, Q0. And therefore, not open. What about if I take I to be the set of all irrationals? Same story. If we take any irrational open interval, there will be a rational sitting inside. Again, A interior is empty, so not open. So the rational numbers are not open. Let me give you another example. Okay, let me make it as a separate example. Okay. Let us consider a function f mapping to R, which is continuous on R. So I have a function defined for all values of R, and at every point it is continuous. So I have a continuous function from R to R. For example, I can take fx equal to x square. This is continuous at every point. Fx equal to sin x, fx equal to cos x. Any one of these I can take, as all continuous for all, defined for all R, and it is continuous at all points. So take one such function, fix it. Okay, take any one of continuous function that you know from R to R. Now, consider metric space. Namely, the R. I am going to consider R with the usual metric. That is, distance between two points is modulus of x minus y. Consider this metric space. Now, in this metric, I am going to look at a set A. The this must be a subset of the real numbers. So I must consider some real numbers, and I'm going to choose these real numbers which go into the set A in a way depending on the function. Yeah, so that F is going to induce this. Okay, I'm going to look at all those points in the real line at which F of x is positive. Look at all those points at which f of x is strictly positive. Now, what can I say about the interior points of this set, and what can I say about the openness or not about this set? Why is that? Because yesterday we saw that if a continuous function is positive at some point, it will maintain its sign in some neighborhood, and therefore all those points in that neighborhood will be that. So already you got a open ball. So because a continuous function maintains its sign in a neighborhood. The set of all points where a continuous function is strictly positive is a open set. We will see later this in the context of matrices. Okay. Okay. So now these open sets have certain fundamental properties. So we are going to look at that. Okay. So let X be, again X row be a metric space and let G be the collection of all open sets in X. I am going to look at all possible open sets in that metric space. Okay. I use the letter G because that is the first letter of the word open in German. Okay. And that is how all these terminologies have come about. Okay. So let us look at the collection of all open sets in the metric space. The first property that we already observe is that these two must be open sets. We have seen that the empty set must be an open set. We have seen that the whole set must be an open set. These two must always be open sets. Whatever metric space you take, the empty set and the whole set must be open. Important point, keep noting that. Okay. Now what I start looking at is basically some kind of a building process. If I start from these open sets, what are certain things that I can build up? Suppose I put two open sets together. One way to put together means I make them interact. I can make them interact with a union or with an intersection. So let us look at that first. Suppose A1 and A2 are open sets. Let me draw a big picture here. Okay, anyway, doesn't matter. So suppose A1 and A2 are open sets in the metric space. Let A be equal to A1 union A2. I have put two open sets together to get a bigger set. Okay. So I have the union of these two open sets. So the question is A an open set? So let's look at that. Okay. So to verify whether A is an open set or not, we must look at each point of A and determine whether it is an interior point or not. So let us take any arbitrary point of A and determine whether it is an interior point or not. So let A be any point in A. The moment A is in A, it has to belong to either A1 or A2. So this implies A belongs to A1 or A belongs to A2. Now if A belongs to A1, A1 is given to be an open set, therefore there will be a ball around A which will lie in A1. In the other case, there will be a ball which will lie around A in A2. So in either case, we can say there exists an R greater than 0 such that B or A is contained in A1 or B or A is contained in A2. One of them, if it A belongs to A1, then there will be a B or A in A1. If A belongs to A2, there is a B or A in A2. And that says there exists an R greater than 0 such that since it belongs to this or this, it belongs to A1 union A2, which is A. So therefore, for every point A, there is positive radius so that the open ball about that belongs to A. So therefore, for every A in R, every A in A, there exists R greater than 0 such that B or A belongs to A, which implies every point is an interior point and therefore A interior is A and therefore A is open. So by putting together two open sets, you are going to get an open set. Now, three open sets together, does the argument change? 4 finite, 100, same argument, 1 million, countably infinite, uncountably infinite, same argument goes through. Okay, so there is no, so analogously, the same argument gives us that if A alpha is any collection in G, that is any collection of open sets, finite, countably infinite, uncountably infinite, then union is also an open set. That's the second important property that we will note. The first important property, okay, I already put the number 2. So the first one is that phi and x are open sets, and you can just go on putting open sets and open sets and open sets, nothing changes. It remains open. So let us see now what will happen if we intersect. So we will now take A1 and A2 in G and let A to be the intersection of A1 and A2. Okay. Is A an open set? So let us draw a picture. Here is X, here is A1, here is A2, I am looking at the intersection. So now I want to determine whether the intersection is an open set. Again, for that I must see whether every point is interior point. So take any point A, so let A belong to J. That says A belongs to A1 and A belongs to A2 and A belongs to A2. Now, since A belongs to A1, there is a circle which belongs to A1. Okay? So, it implies there exists an R1, such that I will save some space. BR1A is contained in A1. Similarly, there will be an R2 such that BR2. So, there exists R1, R2 greater than 0 and BR2A belongs to A2. But my aim is to get a ball which belongs to both A1 and A2. Now, let us draw the picture again, only the ball. So, here is A. Now, if R1 is greater than R2, this will be the radius R1 and this will be the radius R2. This part is in A2 and the part is in A1. So, what happens to the smaller part? It is in both A1 and A2. So, therefore, and in the other case, interchange the role of R1 and R2. So, let R be the minimum of R1 and R2, then BRA is completely contained in A1 intersection A2, which is here. Now, R is greater than 0 because R1 and R2 are positive. Therefore, the minimum of two positive numbers will be positive. So, what have we done? We have shown, take any point A, there is always an open ball which lies in that set. So, therefore, for every A in A, there exists an R greater than 0 such that BRA is contained in A. Therefore, A is open. A interior is A. Therefore, A is open. So, the intersection of two open sets is an open set. What will happen if I put 3? I will be taking minimum of R1, R2, R3, which will still be positive. 4, 6, 100, trillion, million. What happens if I put a countably infinite sequence of? The minimum, suppose R1 turns out to be 1, R2 turns out to be half, R3 turns out to be 1/3, R4 turns out to be 1/4, Rn turns out to be 1n. So, therefore, the R that we will end up choosing will be smaller than 1/n for all n, which means it has to be 0. But then I want a positive radius. So, when you put infinite things together, we may end up in trouble. I will give you an example. But at least now we are guaranteed that if we put finite number of them together, we will be safe. Okay. So, if similarly, if A1, A2, An is a finite collection of open sets, then intersection J equal to 1 to n, Aj is an open set. Therefore, this example is an indication that the one of the new things that we can get starting from open sets is by trying to put infinite number of open sets and intersect them. Possibly you may get something which is not an open set. Okay. Let us look at an example. Let us look at the usual, always First example will be that. Look at the real numbers, the usual metric. Let me look at an to be the interval between minus 1 over n to plus 1 over n. So it is minus 1 over n to plus 1 over n for n to 1, 2, 3, etc. Okay. Are they all open sets? They are all open balls. Every point is an interval. Open interval is an interval, open set. So an are all open set, or all an belongs to G for every n. What is the intersection of A? The intersection, the common point is only the point, single point 0. Is that an open set? Because if that take any interval about that 0, points are all outside that set. This is not an open set. Not an open set. Let us call this a, because a interior is empty and not equal to. So therefore, when you are intersecting infinite number of open sets, do not jump to the conclusion we may or may not have an open set. We may also get an open set, but in general we cannot conclude that it is an open set. So therefore, let us collect all these properties. Now summarize. So let G be the collection of all open sets, then the three fundamental properties are: the whole set and the empty set are definitely open sets, always they are open sets. Two, A alpha or all in G, any collection implies union A alpha is in G. The union of any collection of open set is an open set. And the property 3 is A1, A2, AN, finite number of open set implies intersection J equal to 1 to N, AJ is an open set. Is it clear? These are three fundamental properties of open sets in any metric space. Now, this notion of open sets we got through starting from the metric rho. The metric gave us the notion of an open ball. The notion of open ball gave rise to the notion of an interior point. The notion of an interior point gave rise to the notion of interior. The notion of interior gave rise to the notion of an open set. At the root cause for all this was the metric. However, we can go one step further and say, suppose I had a set X, there is no metric. Okay. However, there is a collection of sets which have these three properties. Okay. So I have an arbitrary set X, out of which I take a collection of subsets which have these three properties. That is, the whole set is in that collection, empty is in this collection, it is closed under arbitrary union, it is closed under finite intersection. Then we will call it a topology in the set. So open sets give us the idea of neighborhood. So use this collection itself as the idea of neighborhood. So this is abstracted as follows. Let X be any non-empty set from now call it tau. Tau be a collection of subsets of X, a collection of subsets of X. This collection behaves like that collection of open sets in a metric space, such that, again I will repeatedly write so that these points get into the mind. 1, X, Y belong to that collection. If A alpha are in that connection, their union is also in that collection. And 3, if A1, A2, AN is in that collection, then the intersection is also in that collection. Okay? Then tau is called the topology on the set X, and X together with this topology is called a topological space. Of course, there are many fundamental questions which I do not, I am not going to discuss. Suppose I have a set A and I have a topology on it. The question will be, can I somehow find a metric such that the open sets that are coming from that is precisely this topology? Then they are called metrizable topologies. Otherwise, they are non-metrizable. There are metrizable, there are non-metrizable topologies. And the easier ones are to study metrizable topologies. So we will therefore look at only metric spaces. Okay, non-metrizable topologies are a little more sophisticated. And even among metrizable topologies, we will look at the metric which is normable, and later we will look at the norm which is inner productable, and get to the notion of inner product spaces and Hilbert spaces. But right now we will concentrate on metric spaces. But the abstraction of this is the notion of a topological space, and if by chance the topological space is such that the topology can be generated by a metric, then it is called a metrizable topology. Okay. The idea of the word topology suggests the idea is of a topology is to give you a notion of neighborhood. The neighborhood in our metric space comes through the notion of distance. Okay. It could come by any other concept. Let me even give you digress a little bit. Suppose I have a set X. Okay. Then I am interested in certain very special subsets of that. I somehow want them to be open sets. I want them definitely to be open set. So in other words, so let us look at this situation. X is a non-empty set. K, a collection of subsets of X. Okay. K may or may not be a topology on X. Okay. What does that mean? Maybe one or two or three of those properties are not satisfied. It may not be, X may not be there in that collection, or phi may not be there in that collection, or it may not be closed under union, or it may not be closed under finite intersection. So something is going wrong in that collection. In other words, it is not a very rich collection. It is a very scattered collection. Many things to do something, you have to go out. To do union, you have to go out. To do intersection, you have to go out, and so on and so forth. It is not a rich collection of sets, but some kind of sparse collection of sets. Now I want to embed this in a topology. That is, I want to build a topology around this. What does that mean? I want to get a bigger collection of sets which includes this K, so that the bigger collection is a topology. But then when I do such a thing, I always do it optimally. The bigger collection should be just that much big that's required. Nothing more, nothing less. So what we want to do is, we want to embed this K in a topology for X in an optimal way. What does that mean? That is, so we want to get hold of a topology. So we want to get a topology tau. Of course, that will depend on the collection you started with. So tau k for x, such that, one, it must be an embedder for k. That is, k is in that tau k, and the tau k must be an optimal embedder. What does that mean? And two, if tau is any topology, any other topology on X such that K is part of it, then it will be bigger than this. Tau K must be a part of tau. Okay. So this is the optimal. Anything smaller than tau K will not work. It will not be a topology. And therefore, that's the optimal size topology that you will be able to get, in which these k chosen sets are necessarily open sets. We do not know whether such a thing exists. We will see that such a thing exists, and the construction that we will do is a typical construction in many places in mathematics. Okay? So we will see that construction. Okay? We will show that such a tau k exists, this tau k. Of course, it's obviously unique because everyone is bigger than him. There is only one such fellow. In fact, any other when I put, then it's strictly contained in tau. Okay, any other topology other than this tau k, it has to be strictly bigger. Okay. This tau k is called the topology induced by k or generated by k. Let's put it this way. So every collection generates a topology. Okay. Just the right amount of required dosage of medicine becomes very healthy. Okay. What is that construction? How do we get this TK? How do we see such a T? You know, such a tau K exists. Now, first of all, let us say this part is a reasonable question, that we want to embed this in a topology. If that itself is not possible, then there is no question of optimally doing. You can't even do it. What is the big deal about doing it optimally? Okay. So let's make sure that given a set K, collection of sets of the given big set X, there is at least one way of embedding K into a topology. What is that? The biggest topology is take all possible subsets. So take biggest topology and anything is a part of that. So let's make that statement clear. So there is at least one topology on X such that K is contained in X, K in topology tau, namely tau equal to power set of X. So therefore, if that is the only one, that is the optimal. The question comes where there are many. So let sigma K be, let me put it this, sigma K be the collection of all topologies on X that contain K. All the possible topologies that will contain K. Collection is non-empty because Px is a part of this. There is at least one topology which contains K. So Px is part of this. So Px, I should write, belongs to sigma K because each element of this is a topology. Okay. So Px is a topology. So Px belongs to sigma K and therefore sigma K is a non-empty collection. Okay, so once we have all these fellows, let's take the intersection of all those fellows. So what do? Let T be equal to intersection of all tau, so that tau belongs to sigma K. So I'm going to intersect all the topologies that contain K. If by chance this itself is a topology, what happens? It will become the smallest, okay? Because the intersection of all the fellows is a part of everybody else, and if this fellow is a topology, then he is a part of every other topology, so he becomes the smallest topology. So if T is a topology on X containing K, then obviously this will be the smallest topology on X containing K. And hence equal to, what did I call it? Tau K, the smallest topology. So there are two parts that we have to show, that this is a topology and it contains. The intersection is indeed a topology. We have to show if T is a topology on X, and then we have to show containing K. Now containing K is obvious because K is a part of everybody and therefore K is a part of the intersection also. So clearly K is contained in tau for every tau in sigma K, and therefore K is contained in intersection tau, so that tau belongs to sigma K, and therefore K is contained in T. That's not a problem. So what is left? It shows that T is a topology. to show that T is a topology, all we have to do is verify those three conditions. X and phi are there, closed under union, closed under finite intersection. So, exercise, verify that T is a topology, is indeed a topology. By verifying the three axioms for topology. Example, the first axiom, what does it say? X and phi should be there. Let us say X. Since everybody is a topology, X must be in tau. X is in tau for everybody, so it is in the intersection. Phi is tau for everybody, so phi is in the intersection. If you take a union, you have to show that the union is an open set. Take a point in the union, he will be in one of them. Okay, then that fellow is a topology. Okay, so I will leave it as an it's a very trivial exercise. So I will leave it as a okay. So now, this is called the topology generated by. So, in other words, you can always build a topology around a collection of sets. However, it is not guaranteed that it will be metrizable. So, non-metrizable topologies is beyond the purview of this course. We will not discuss that at all. We will talk about only topologies that arise out of metrics. Now, if we take a metric space, in the place A, you take all open bulbs. Take the collection of all open bulbs. Obviously, the union of two open bulbs is not an open bulb. Therefore, this collection is not a topology. Right? If you take the collection of all open bulbs, this is not a topology. What is the topology that this open bulbs generate? Does that make sense? If you start with any collection, any set X and any collection of subsets, it generates a topology. So, I start with a metric space, I take the collection of the subsets to be the open balls, it will generate a topology. What is that topology? Precisely the open sets that we got. Okay, precisely the open sets we got. So, note, okay, another exercise for you to ponder about. So, the more exercises I got, probably slowly the number will get reduced. Okay. Exercise, verify that if X is a metric space, and K is the collection of all open balls, what do I mean? Every possible center and every possible radius, okay, all open balls in X row, then tau k, the topology generated by k, is equal to g, the set of the collection of all open. Okay, so therefore, these are the natural topology that we will work in a metric space. So that topology is already metrizable. It has come from a metric. The topology generated by this open ball is metrizable, and the metric is precisely the metric we started with. Okay. Right. So now, if you look at the construction that we did to make the topology which embeds any given collection, this is a typical construction. Same thing we will be doing when we do vector spaces and we are given an arbitrary collection of sets, it may not be a subspace. Then we want to embed it in a subspace and we want to do it optimally. What do? We take the collection of all possible such subspaces which embed this, intersect them, and that will be a subspace and that will be the optimal subspace. In measure theory you will do, I am given a collection of sets, I want to get, or in a probability theory, I am interested in the sample space certain particular events. Now I want to generate the sigma field which embeds all these events and I want to do it optimally. How do I do it? Again, take all possible sigma fields which contain this, intersect them, that's a sigma field and that will be the optimal sigma field. So this is this way of taking every possible fellow, intersecting them and getting the smallest one. It's a very typical construction in many places. Okay, these are all what are known as the subspace generated by this set, the sigma algebra generated by this set, the topology generated by this set, and so on and so forth. Okay. Now we have seen that if you start with open sets and go on doing union, you don't get anything new. You go on doing intersection, you don't get anything new. If you do only finite, there is a chance of getting new when you do infinite intersection. That's one thing. So we'll start seeing what are the new things that come out. Even as it is, when we take an open set and just look at its other side, the complement, that may not be open. Okay, we give a name for that. For example, so the complement, let us take for example the real line and look at this open set. What is its complement? It goes all the way from minus infinity to 0 and 1 to infinity. This is obviously not an open set because this fellow, if I draw a neighbor, he goes there. So therefore the complement of an open set is not necessarily an open set, and therefore we give a name for it. So let's now see now the things that we can get out of, other things that we will get out of open sets. Okay, so now that's what the notion of closed sets is. Okay, so X row, this is also true in wherever I say open sets, then it is also can be said in the topological space. But when I say open ball, I will not be talking about a general topological space, but only a metric space. So, X row, a metric space. We will discuss only metric spaces, general topological spaces is not. So, suppose X row is a topological space, and if A contained in X is said to be a closed set, if A complement is an open set. So we are looking at complements of open sets. So A is A complement complement. So it is the complement of an open set. So if the complement is open, this fellow is called closed. So it's not that not open means closed. It doesn't mean that not open means closed. For example, this set is not open and is not closed also. Okay, so therefore not open does not mean not closed. Complement open means closed. So a set is said to be closed if its complement is open. Okay. Now the properties of the open sets complemented will give the properties of the closed set. So what are the properties of the open set? X is an open set. So its complement, the empty set, must be a closed set. The empty set is an open set. So its complement must be a closed set. So X and Y both become closed sets. So they are both open and closed. Okay. So from properties of open sets, we get the following properties of closed sets. So let F, this is again the first letter of the word closed for in German, F be the collection of all closed sets. Then x phi open, we will say phi closed. The same thing is x and phi are closed sets. So, what is the corresponding version of the union of any number of open sets is an open set. Become the intersection of any collection of closed sets will be closed sets. Okay. So, the reverse, it will get reversed to A alpha or closed sets implies the intersection alpha, A alpha is a closed set. And finite intersection of open sets is open becomes finite union of closed sets is closed. A1, A2, AN closed sets implies union J equal to 1 to N, J is a closed set. Suppose I give an arbitrary set in the matrix space. Okay, I will raise certain questions now. Now I want to extract the largest interior. I want to construct my house in that site. So I want to get the maximum possible space available for me to construct the house. Okay. So I want to extract the largest, that is the interior of that set. That is, so largest open set inside is the interior. This we really proved. Similarly, I want finally put the compound wall. So I want the closed set that will embed this, but then my compound should not get into the other fellow. So I want to do it very optimal. Otherwise, the corporation fellow will come and beat me up. So therefore, I want to embed, extract the essence, namely the largest open set inside and the smallest closed set outside. Okay. So therefore, given a set A, A in X row in the metric space, we want the largest open set in A and the smallest closed set containing A. Let me look at one of the constructions first. So let us look at the closed set. You see, again we will repeat our construction. Given something, we want to optimally embed it. Remember, we were given a collection of sets, we wanted to optimally embed it in a topology. Now we are given a set, we want to optimally embed it in a closed set. So what should be the construction? Take all possible closed sets which embed this, intersect them. The intersection must be a closed set by our property, because intersection of any closed, and that obviously is the smallest. So that construction will keep on appearing again and again and again. Whenever you want to embed something optimally outside, then take all possible, intersect, you are done. Okay. So now, so let FA be the collection of all closed sets that contain A. But all sets containing A. Let me put it, use the same word, containing A. Do we know at least one such closed set which contains A? Namely the X, because X is a closed set. Obviously A is in X, so X belongs to FA. Therefore, FA is a non-empty collection. Okay. Let FA be equal to the intersection of all F so that F belongs to A. Clearly, it is a closed set because the intersection of any collection of closed sets is closed set. So, FA is closed. FA belongs to F by property 2 of closed sets, and then A is contained in FA because A is contained in F for every F and FA, and FA is contained in F for every F in F. Therefore, FA is the smallest closed set containing A. Okay. And this is called the closure of A. The compound has been erected. Okay. This is called the closure of A. This is called closure of A. And is denoted by A with a bar. Okay. If A is already a closed set, what is A closure? Itself, because that is already embedded, so it is the smallest closed set containing A. So, only the question arises when we are dealing with non-closed sets, how to embed. If it is a closed set, already A closure is equal to A. So, A is a closed set. A is a closed set. If and only if A closure is equal to A. Okay. How do you think the construction of the largest open set will go? In the closed set case, we wanted all the closed sets which contain A. Now we want all the open sets which are contained in A. There we took the intersection. Now we will take the union and show that is an open set, show that is the largest and so on and so forth. Okay? So similarly, let me put it this way. Again, exercise. Exercise means just put these things together. Similarly, the largest open set GA containing A is the union of all open sets inside A and verify that GA is precisely the integer. Precisely that will turn out to be the integer of A. So we know what is the essence from inside we can squeeze out, and what is the optimal closing that we can closure of the set and the interior of the set. These are the interior of the set is the largest open set that is lying inside, and the closure is the smallest closed set that is lying outside, enclosing this. Okay, these two are two important concepts. Now we will look at closed sets from a different point of view. Okay, next time we will look at closed sets from a different point of view and see that all these are linked. Okay, the other way we look at and this way we look at the closure, they are all linked together. So we will see that the notion of closed sets can be approached through the notion of limit points. Okay, so there is this situation. We can approach all these topological ideas from the notion of open sets, and that notion of open sets may come from a metric. Okay, so we have on the one hand the open sets. The metric space gives the notion of open sets, and through open sets we can look at the notion of topology, the neighborhood ideas. On the other hand, we can look at the notion of limit points. From the notion of limit points, we can come to the notion of closed sets. From the notion of closed sets, we can come to the notion of open sets as the complements, and therefore we will get a topology. So therefore, wherever you have a convergence idea, limit idea, you automatically get into a topology. So therefore, you will see in many places the topology is defined through the notion of convergence. Okay. The moment you have a notion of convergence, you have a notion of limit points. The moment you have the notion of limit points, you have the notion of closed sets. The moment you have the notion of closed sets, you have the notion of open sets, and your topology comes into the picture. So most of the cases, when it comes to applications, many, many places, the topology will be induced through a notion of convergence. For example, there is a long gap between the time when the physicist got the idea of the delta function to the time Schwarz gave a proper mathematical meaning for the delta function. Okay, and finally, Schwarz had to give a certain topological idea for all these things. And he defined convergence in a certain space, in a certain collection of functions, in a particular manner, and through that convergence he had the topology, and all the topological ideas came through that. So there are various ways of understanding topological notions, and the more intuitive ways are through convergence. And so therefore we look at in the next class the notion of limit points, and from that how we can move forward and then link the two. And therefore we will keep in mind, I can approach it either way. Wherever it is convenient, I will approach it through limit points and convergence notions, and wherever it is convenient, I will approach through the notion of open set. So these options keep open so that we can approach the problem in a convenient manner. Okay, I think I will stop here.